I think we have a very skewed point of view on an awful lot of things, but let's try and see where our point of view comes from. Imagine early man. Early man is like everything else, an evolved creature, and he finds himself in a world that he's begun to take a little charge of. He's begun to be a toolmaker, a changer of his environment with the tools that he's made, and he makes tools when he does in order to make changes in his environment. To give an example of the way man operates compared to other animals, consider speciation, which, as we know, tends to occur when a small group of animals gets separated from the rest of the herd by some geological upheaval, population pressure, food shortage, or whatever, and finds itself in a new environment with maybe something different going on. Take a very simple example. Maybe a bunch of animals suddenly finds itself in a place where the weather is rather colder. We know that in a few generations, those genes which favor a thicker coat will have come to the fore, and we'll come and we'll find that the animals have now got thicker coats. Early man, who's a toolmaker, doesn't have to do this. He can inhabit an extraordinarily wide range of habitats on Earth, from tundra to the Gobi Desert. He even manages to live in New York, for heaven's sake. And the reason is that when he arrives in a new environment, he doesn't have to wait for several generations. If he arrives in a colder environment and sees an animal that has those genes which favor a thicker coat, he says, "I'll have it off him." Tools have enabled us to think intentionally, to make things and to do things to create a world that fits us better. Now imagine an early man surveying his surroundings at the end of a happy day's toolmaking. He looks around and he sees a world which pleases him mightily. Behind him are mountains with caves in. Mountains are great because you can go and hide in the caves and you're out of the rain and the bears can't get you. In front of him there's the forest. It's got nuts and berries and delicious food. There's a stream going by which is full of water. Water's delicious to drink. You can float your boats in it and do all sorts of stuff with it. Here's Cousin Ugg, and he's got a mammoth. Mammoths are great. You can eat them. You can wear their coats. You can use their bones to create weapons to catch other mammoths. I mean, this is a great world. It's fantastic. But our early man has a moment to reflect, and he thinks to himself, "Well, this is an interesting world that I find myself in." And then he asks himself a very treacherous question, a question which is totally meaningless and fallacious, but only comes about because of the nature of the sort of person he is, the sort of person he has evolved into, and the sort of person who has thrived because he thinks this particular way. Man the Maker looks at his world and says, "So who made this then? Who made this?" You can see why it's a treacherous question. Early man thinks, "Well, because there's only one sort of being I know about who makes things, whoever made all this must therefore be a much bigger, much more powerful, and necessarily invisible one of me. And because I tend to be the strong one who does all the stuff, he's probably male." And so we have the idea of a god. Then, because when we make things, we do it with the intention of doing something with them, early man asks himself, if he made it, what did he make it for? Now the real trap springs, because early man is thinking, this world fits me very well. Here are all these things that support me and feed me and look after me. Yes, this world fits me nicely. And he reaches the inescapable conclusion that whoever made it for him. This is rather as if you imagine a puddle waking up one morning and thinking, this is an interesting world I find myself in, an interesting hole I find myself in. Fits me rather neatly, doesn't it? In fact, it fits me staggeringly well. Must have been made to have me in it. This is such a powerful idea that as the sun rises in the sky and the air heats up, and as gradually the puddle gets smaller and smaller, it's still frantically hanging on to the notion that everything's going to be all right because this world was meant to have him in it, was built to have him in it. So the moment he disappears, catches him rather by surprise. I think this may be something we need to be on the watch out for. I would like somebody to write an evolutionary history of religion, because the way in which it has developed seems to me to show all kinds of evolutionary strategies. Think of the arms races that go on between one or two animals living in the same environment. For example, the race between the Amazonian manatee and a particular type of reed that it eats. The more of the reed the manatee eats, the more the reed develops silica in its cells to attack the teeth of the manatee, and the more silica in the reed, the more manatee's teeth get bigger and stronger. One side does one thing and the other counters it. As we know, throughout evolution and history, Arms races are something that drive evolution in the most powerful ways. And in the world of ideas, you can see similar kinds of things happening. Now, the invention of the scientific method and science is, I'm sure we'll all agree, the most powerful intellectual idea, the most powerful framework for thinking and investigating and understanding and challenging the world around us that there is. And that it rests on the premise that any idea is there to be attacked. And if it withstands the attack, then it lives to fight another day. And if it doesn't withstand the attack, then down it goes. Religion doesn't seem to work like that. It has certain ideas at the heart of it, which we call sacred or holy or whatever. That's an idea we're so familiar with, whether we subscribe to it or not, that it's kind of odd to think what it actually means. Because really, what it means is, here is an idea or a notion that you're not allowed to say anything bad about. You're just not. Why not? Because you're not. If somebody votes for a party that you don't agree with, you're free to argue about it as much as you like. Everybody will have an argument, but nobody feels aggrieved by it. If somebody thinks taxes should go up or down, you are free to have an argument about it. But on the other hand, if somebody says, I mustn't move a light switch on a Saturday, you say, fine, I respect that. The odd thing is, even as I am saying that, I am thinking, is there an Orthodox Jew here who is going to be offended by the fact that I just said that? But I wouldn't have thought, maybe there's somebody from the left wing, or somebody from the right wing, or somebody who subscribes to this view or the other in economics, when I was making the other points. I just think, fine, we have different opinions. But the moment I say something that has something to do with somebody's, I'm going to stick my neck out here and say, irrational beliefs, then we all become terribly protective and terribly defensive and say, no, we don't attack that. That's an irrational belief, but no, we respect it. It's rather like if you think back in terms of animal evolution, an animal that's grown an incredible carapace around it, such as a tortoise. That's a great survival strategy because nothing can get through it. Or maybe like a poisonous fish that nothing will come close to, which therefore thrives by keeping away any challenges to what it is. In the case of an idea, if we think, here is an idea that is protected by holiness or sanctity, what does it mean? Why should it be that it's perfectly legitimate to support the Labour Party or the Conservative Party, Republicans or Democrats, this model of economics versus that, Macintosh instead of Windows, but to have an opinion about how the universe began, about who created the universe, no, that's holy. What does that mean? Why do we ring-fence that for any other reason other than that we've just got used to doing so? There's no other reason at all. It's just one of those things that crept into being, and once that loop gets going, it's very, very powerful. So we are used to not challenging religious ideas, but it's very interesting how much of a furor Richard creates when he does it. Everybody gets absolutely frantic about it because you're not allowed to say these things. Yet, when you look at it rationally, there is no reason why those ideas shouldn't be as open to debate as any other, except that we have agreed somehow between us that they shouldn't be.